All right, so now we're joined by Debora Juarez, who's running for City Council District 5. So go ahead with a two-minute introduction.
Good afternoon or good evening. It's nice meeting you. My name is Debora Juarez, and I'm running for Seattle City Council District 5. A little bit about myself before I go into my professional background. I was born and raised in the Cal Reservation. I am 55 years old, and we have two children, a 21 and a 24-year-old. I've been a lawyer for 28 years, and I started as a public defender, and then I went to legal services, where I represented tribes. That was before we had casinos. And then I went to King County Superior Court judge, and then I went to go work for Governor Lowry in law in Olympia. Then I went to go work at a major investment firm on Wall Street for 4 years, and then I found myself at the law firm of Williams & Kastner, where I started the tribal practice group. I've lived in the neighborhood for 25 years, five different neighborhoods in the North End as a renter and a homeowner. Both my girls went to Eckstein and Nathan Hale. One graduated from Sarah Lawrence. One is presently going to North Seattle College. The reason why I'm running for Seattle City Council is, to be honest with you, I know that I would not have run if I didn't move to a district system. To me, a district system just seems a very natural fit for me, because coming from a tribal community, role member of the Blackfeet Nation, representing just about every tribe in the state and beyond, it only made sense that you should go live with the people that you represent to know the issues. So the North End worked out great for me, because I know it by the back of my hand. I know it's 13 square miles, 90,000 people, with the median ranges. But more importantly, I lived there and bought homes there and raised my kids there.
Great, thank you. So now we have four prepared questions, and you have a copy in front of you if you want to turn it over. So David, do you want to start with the first question? These are two-minute answers.
Let's start at 10 o'clock.
Oh, sure. We can start with Clayton, if you'd like to think first.
Thank you. Seattle is experiencing a housing affordability crisis. Several policy responses have been suggested, including linkage fees, incentive zoning, subsidized housing, and rent control, among others. What is your approach to keeping Seattle affordable?
My approach to keeping Seattle affordable, and I'm really glad that rent control is in here, because as you know, in 1980, the city of Seattle tried to pass rent control, and it was vehemently shut down. But in 1980, Jimmy Carter was the president, and a lot has changed since then. In answering this question, my approach to keeping Seattle affordable is having more low-income housing, more market rate housing, also not having it so concentrated, so you can find that you have these concentrated poverty areas. Also looking at areas of transit-oriented development, transit-oriented living, and there's other new terms that are out there, but it's basically, since we've moved to a transit system, that you have an area where you can build out housing for people who actually use transit, because as we know, poverty is moving north, and if it's moving north, we're learning through the studies all the way back to the Growth Management Act that the North End isn't, transit needs aren't being met. So if the needs aren't being met, people are spending more money trying to get to work and less money on, or more money on, and less money on housing and food and necessities. So I actually agree with rent control, but we can call it something else. I like the idea of linkage fees and incentive zoning. Working for tribes and the federal government and the state government, I certainly don't want to deal with developers, and also being an underwriter. And during my time as a financial advisor, in which I managed millions of dollars for tribes and municipalities where we issued debt and loans for things such as, building things. I built things from, like I said, from casinos to hospitals to low-income housing to pools to golf courses, you name it. Anything that the government can build, a tribe can build, you pretty much can build them. So, and housing is like the number one issue, not only in Indian country, but also an issue I dealt with when I worked at local services.
Great, thank you. Mary, number two.
Last year, voters approved a levy to fund the Universal Preschool Pilot Program. After the pilot concludes, how would you fund the full implementation of the program? And what policy changes would you make to assure that this plan addresses educational disparities in the city?
concern about doing the funding for a program, as I learned, I don't talk about that at the end. Traditionally, what you do is you have a backup plan, so when a pilot program ends, you either have money set aside and look for state and federal matching funds, and you also look to the private sector to assist you to match those funds. I'm not a big proponent of levies unless, of course, it's for a social need or a need which addresses social injustice, like homelessness, education, things that we need in the community. When you ask me what policy changes would you make to ensure this plan addresses educational disparities in our city, you know, I would have to look to the school districts and to the school boards and work with them, because we know that educational disparities exist. How we address them can't be just throwing money at them. It has to be in targeted areas, and particularly if I'm representing the North End, we know that we have 8 elementary schools, 2 middle schools, or 8 elementary schools, 3 middle schools, and 2 elementary schools. Did I say that right?
8, 3, 2.
High schools, 2 high schools, I'm sorry. So 8, 3, 2, that's right. So I think you have to look at that, where we're at with those institutions first, and track what we've done in the pilot program, how well we've gotten to transition those kids into the school system, to the public school system, or if we've kept them, or if we lost them, or how we lost them. I think that's all I can really answer to that.
John, number 3.
Okay. So Bertha is stuck. What options does the city of Seattle have with respect to potential cost overruns, waterfront transit, and an unsafe byway?
Well, as a lawyer, and I've represented both sides, developers, private government, private sector, and also as a builder, where we've gone, you know, over budget and over time, and sometimes under budget and under time, this is a contractual issue. And I don't believe that the taxpayers of Seattle would be responsible to potential cost overruns. You have to have a backup plan. Seattle Tunnel Partners, or I can't remember what they're called, the STP. And to tell you the truth, as a lawyer, I've been following it on the developer side and the contractual side. And I guess what it really comes down to just, and I don't want to sound flippant, but it really comes down to the contractual obligations consideration that was given, and the city and the taxpayers would be on the hook for these type of cost overruns. I just couldn't see where that would happen. And without actually looking at the contract, just from what I've read and working with the developers in my firm, I have an idea of how these kind of deals work out. And we usually have built-in safeguards for this very reason, and I'm sure the city of Seattle would have that.
Room number 4.
Seattle is the fastest growing big city in the country. Should we encourage or discourage the growth? And what policy changes are necessary to accommodate the growth?
This is actually a really good question. I think that we should encourage growth, but I don't believe that you can pave or pollute your way to prosperity. I don't believe that growth means pouring more concrete. I believe, and I don't know if you guys remember this in the 90s when they used to say growth, grace, progress, not perfection. I know those were great reminders, but they really did make sense. So I would encourage growth. I would encourage growth beyond outside of downtown corridor. And we know that District 5 has 3 urban centers that are already zoned for growth, including Lake City Way. Because I know Lake City has an opportunity to, has really been targeted in the mayor's last 2 plans about how we do economic development. And as far as policy changes necessary to accommodate growth, again, we would come back to the developers and the type of, and this is what I've learned working in Indian country and outside, is with developers, you can negotiate on what we would call horse trade what you want. Linkage fees, you can call it what you want. You're going to put in this street, you're going to put in this light, you're going to do this roundabout. That's what the Tulalip tribe did with Snohomish County, which I was involved in. If we're going to put in this casino and you're going to build this, then the tribe will pay for this, and the developer's going to pay for this, and the county's not going to be on the hook for whatever else, for any kind of surrounding infrastructure. So I think when people think that developers or people are going to come in, there's going to be growth, that somehow everything's going to get paid, and you're going to have, you know, a Starbucks and a yoga studio and a slushy place on every corner. And I simply don't see Seattle like that anymore.
Great, so now we'll go to follow-up questions. These are one-minute answers. Elizabeth and Renee.
So you've done economic development.
Yes.
And I'm not very knowledgeable, but I know there are at least two theories about economic development. And one is to bring in large companies that provide lots of jobs for people. And the other one is to create a more localized economy, a more holistic view of smaller businesses, and then building out their supply chains within the state, over
in
the region. What's your
focus? I'm really glad you asked that. In fact, I almost feel like I hate you to ask me that. I did a study with the governor and the state legislature that was the first of its kind regionally and nationally, and I ended up in the Wall Street Journal. It was a tribal economic vitality initiative. We never use the word economic development because we believe economic development and really meant economic empowerment, which made community-based. Because I grew up where developers came in, built stuff, and it didn't work, and they were gone and had empty buildings, right? And so when you look at economic development, I never liked that term. I like the word economic empowerment or community development, is you have to build, you have to bring the building and the jobs to the people so the people can walk to work or take quick transit to work, and you're not displacing them. And it fits, and it has to come, it has to be homegrown, or else it won't work. Casinos were different from tribes. We did that because we had to. Trust me, tribes did not want to be in the business of fireworks, alcohol, cigarettes, and we used to call it a contraband economy. So we were forced into doing that because of our fights with the state and the federal government. But it kind of goes to what you were saying. I'm more of a holistic, the community has to be for it, or it can't get done. I'm sorry.
We're out of time. Okay, so Renee, and then I have a question. I'm clicking.
So in the North End, there's a growing demand for social services, and I'm wondering if you could speak to a coordinated effort you might envision for social services being provided in North End, in particular off of Aurora.
Actually, that's a good question because our law firm and I am affiliated with the Helpline Social Services Organization. Our firm does all the pro bono work for them, and we've done work with them. I did the tour with them, so I. Helpline has the food bank, the social services, helps people find housing. So when I was up there talking to the Helpline people, I also met a lot of people from the university district. I also volunteered at the Woods on the Ave. So we were talking about what kind of orchestrated effort, now that we're in a district system, that we could actually build a coalition so we're not spread out to north of Seattle. People who are using services in the U district coming up to Lake City, people who are on this side of Aurora are coming over and depleting resources over here. Now that we're in a district system, I think it's going to be easier to coordinate social services, services for homeless, services for youth, LGBT, those kind of issues, which is actually really exciting. That's never happened before. And I think there are really good things happening now that we're into a district system.
Great. Well, actually, skip myself. So Clayton, then Joseph.
I'd like to return to the problem of housing for a moment, because it's a circular problem, it seems.
Yes.
In that buildings, new construction is built by developers. Intervention, economic intervention by the city or the state in the construction process means that the cost rise. Because the costs rise, other housing also increases in cost. So my question is very simple and maybe simple-minded, but the question is, how do we break the circularity of that problem? Because it really does very circular to me and pretty tough.
That's a really difficult question because a lot of that is market driven. Excuse me if I'm not understanding. So you're saying like when more stuff gets
built, that's the point. It's market driven. And developers have an excuse, maybe a reason, but also an excuse to increase costs. Other developers who are totally unrelated, so they also have this.
That gets back to what I've done for 28 years in dealing with developers and builders, and I'm a builder myself, is, you know, you negotiate those things. You tell it, like, what we would say is, okay, if you're going to build this housing, you're going to employ 40% of this group of our people, we stabilized it from 80% medium for all our years. These are the amenities that you are going to provide to the community that aren't just connected with the 10-story low-income housing or better rooted shelter we're building. Those are the kind of things that we can negotiate. I think what Seattle has a tendency to do, which is kind of annoying, is kind of box themselves into a corner that there's only a few models you can use for the developer. When you sit down and negotiate, it's open season.
Okay, so Joseph and Altamine, David, did you want to question? We have time.
So what would be the first piece of legislation you would introduce?
Interesting you should say that. The first, and I don't want to say it would be the first piece, but it's something that we've been talking about, and something that I'd like to work with my fellow council members, is we would like to look at giving tax breaks to people that use electric cars. And also look at companies like Lyft and Uber, since they have such a huge business here model, and a lot of employees, and a lot of drivers, and using that as an incentive to give them a tax break for the electric cars, and maybe expand that down the road to, I don't want to say more tax, but perhaps a fee of people who aren't using cars that are not completely fossil fuel.
So initiative 122 has been filed and is collecting signatures. That if it's enough signatures, we put on the ballot a small levy that would fund a public financing campaign system for city elections. Do you support that, and how do you think it would affect campaigns in Seattle?
Is that the one where people get vouchers?
Right.
Okay. I'm going to be straightforward with you. I listened to the gentleman speak at the 36th about it. I did not sign the petition. I read a little bit more about it, and I quite frankly couldn't give you a definitive answer without Andrew.
Fair enough.
I believe in free speech. I believe Citizens United was way off and wrong. I don't believe we should have a constitutional amendment to change that, because I think that's like taking a drink of water from a fire hydrant. I think when you mess with the Constitution, that's a whole other ballgame. But I do believe that there has to be finance, and I think we can do something different than a voucher, but I do think something needs to get done. I haven't seen anything. I've heard different ideas, but I haven't seen anything, at least to me, that makes sense that would pass constitutional muster. And I don't want to waste time and money on something that is going to be challenging and ultimately something like it. The Citizens United is very powerful, as you know.
Right. David, then.
So we're going to be talking to a lot of candidates for city council over the next couple of years. And a fair number of them are from the 5th. So I've really enjoyed listening to your answers on questions about issues. What's your grand game to, other than perhaps getting our right, which is the gold standard. But right, what's your grounding to win this election in the 5th district that you know so well and you seem to be pretty well prepared on the issues? How are you going to win the election?
I'm going to win this election. Well, let's do the two part. If you look at me on paper, it looks great. And, you know, poor Indian girl, college, law school, partnered with a big firm, worked for two governors, worked on Wall Street. All those were institutions that were not made for me, and somehow I managed to get through all that. So for me, and when I was a King County Superior Court judge, and I got filed against, that was almost 20 years ago, I've learned a lot in 20 years. education, economic development, affordable housing, homelessness, and these social issues. I've dealt with every one of these issues personally, as a child, as an adult, as a human being, but also as a lawyer, as a developer, and as a leader. And I have 28 years of doing that, and nobody else can touch my record there. And I've been in this neighborhood, like I said, for 25 years.
So, and I'm sorry, Elizabeth, we're completely out of time now. So we take no more than 30 seconds in a conclusory statement.
Well, this is kind of nice. I never really came to a closing. I feel like, you know, I feel like you guys are kind of like a jury, except I'm not a public defender. I'm not a public defender. I have a guilty client sitting with me, so I like. I want to say that I really want this job because the timing for me is not only right, but the timing, I think Seattle is ready for somebody like me. I'm not too far left, I'm not too far right. I'm not even really in the middle sometimes, but what I really am is I'm really smart, and I get on top of the facts, and I drill down on the issues. And I don't like to pander, and what you see is what you get, and you can always be sure that I'm going to be straight with you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.